really, really pleased to be asked to share a little bit about how we flexed the Lowe's brand as we came into Manhattan. It's going to be a real little because I realize we're running short on time. I'm going to try to flip through pretty quickly. But suffice to say that just about everything had to flex in order to make what you traditionally know as, of Lowe's as a big box retailer work in an area like Manhattan. Just about everything. What doesn't flex is what we stand for. What doesn't flex is what people walk under the sign, the Lowe's sign, to get and what they expect when they do that. And so you can see we've been helping customers love where they live, helping them improve and maintain their home at a value for over 60 years, from that upper shot to the traditional big box that most of us know, all the way to Manhattan. And whether you are on a time warp back to the 1950s, or if you live in Manhattan today, when you walk through the door, the expectation is that you're going to be able to get whatever you need, everything you need to improve and maintain your home at a value. So everything home improvement. The difference that we learned, and really the strategic intent that we held true to throughout the process, was that everything changes depending on where you live, how you live. Whether you live in a rural community or you live in Manhattan, you're a renter or you're a homeowner, everything really changes and depends on your certain situation. And so that's what we held true to. It's a lot of fun trying to figure out what everything means. And the research that was done was amazing. And it went well beyond just quant studies, but really getting to know the customer and what it was that they were looking for, how they lived, how they associate with the community, the shopping norms that they were dealing with. Was really a great study in human nature, and it gave us the framework. And knowing that we need to provide everything, combined with the deep customer knowledge that we got from the research group and the research team, gave us the framework to really feel confident in what we were about to do. So, giving the customer what they want. Once you know what they want, we really think it's important to give it to them. I think that's pretty obvious. For us. It starts with the assortment. So what is it? What are the types of products that they really desire? This is a great shot for a lot of different reasons. One, the small appliance assortment is not something we carry in our typical stores. So it's a new addition to the Manhattan stores because it's critical to the small apartment living of Manhattanites. Two, we've got a selection there. You can see a left brain, right brain type of thinking there, where there's some things that are there, grab and go, you take with and transact. There's a lot of products in our store that they don't necessarily need that day. And so we deliver it next day or the following day from the about 1 million square feet that we have of retail surrounding Manhattan. So a lot of study going into not only what they need, but when they need it. And I think that's an important distinction as we start to deal with the constraint of space, is really understanding when does the customer want to get it and how do they want to get it delivered to their home. It's not just about product, though. It's also about service. And we're really, really big on service. This is an interesting one. I love it because it's analog. It's not a digital experience. I know that most of the floor is all about digital. This is a potting station, not something you typically see in suburbia where you could just throw a bag of dirt in your trunk, grab the stuff, and do it in your backyard. Here, the customer grabs a pot. They grab a plant, we put it together for them, and they wrap it up, and they either gift it or they bring it home to enjoy. And it's been a really, really popular piece of the store, and it just shows that we understand what they're dealing with, and we understand what they need, and we're giving it to them. On the digital side, we get a lot of press, a lot of discussion around digital and how do you bring digital in. We were really, really focused on making sure that we weren't going to bring any digital in that wasn't going to answer for a true local customer need or really deal with a market constraint. This is a neat one because it does both, and it's actually out there. Our partner T1 has it out on the floor right now, and you can see it live in both of our stores. But this situation was really driven from the desire to show more breadth of what we do offer and recognizing that there was a constraint on the size of the space for these major appliances, and where we might typically have 70 or 80 refrigerators on the floor, in this store we might only have 20. So we wanted to showcase, we call this the next aisle over, and what we did is we wanted to share with the customer what would we have put in if we had one more aisle. So it's not endless aisle, because when you have endless aisle with a situation like this, you're going to run into a whole lot of asset generation problems. That's a 4K res screen, really amplified, magnified, and so it's a real problem for asset, dealing with your asset, digital assets. But this one here is really the next aisle over, so they can touch and feel the different brands, they can see the different colors across the floor, and then say, well, I want the Samsung, or I want the, you know, the GE or something, but I want it in a slightly different configuration. We can bring them over the next aisle, show them the 3D, show them what it looks like inside, and it's a really, really cool experience. Again, driven by that consumer need of seeing additional depth, as well as the space constraint. All of the digital changes that we made in the store deal with that, whether it's the mobile checkout that allow us to double our register count instantly by just deploying the mobile checkout devices, or if it's the way in which we deal with this top stock and moving stock from the basement into a shelf sales position. The next piece is meeting the customer where they are. When you know the shopping norms, you can do a much better job of taking the shop to them. If we don't do that, we feel as though you're going to spend the rest of our lives trying to market and get them to go three streets over. So we've got two great corner locations, meeting the customer where they're at. This is a great shot of the Chelsea location, which really gives a good perspective. We've got the first floor and the second floor. Left brain, right brain thinking says, keep everything that's grab and go on the first floor, and let's put a nice quiet design center where people can spend some time thinking about their kitchen or bath remodel up on the second floor. It's the coolest design center in New York. I think it's the coolest one in the company, so make sure you check that one out in Chelsea. We've got the same type of thinking on the Upper West Side. This is a shot of the Upper West Side store. It's just on a single floor. But when you look at this and meeting the customer where they're at, we're literally meeting them where they're at. This is the first time our company's ever had this type of community access where there's not a parking lot and a freeway and a couple of on and off ramps between where they live and where they shop. And so it's been really exciting to start to meet the community and go out. You can see the red vest going out the front door to actually greet people and welcome them to the store. Showing up well, this goes a little bit back to some of the Microsoft stuff. Showing up well for us is critical. I think it's critical for anyone who's going to enter into a new market. This is a great example of one of the Heroes projects that we did, which we do every year and on an ongoing basis. This was the grand opening one where we helped the Lincoln Square Development Association repair all the benches. So we refinished all the benches in that area, 10-block area. Which was a lot of fun. We got a lot of red vests out there, scrubbing benches, talking with customers, just kind of putting a good face on for the community and really making sure that they knew that we were there to help. Because loving where you live isn't just the home that you live in. I think in the city, it's extended out to the broader community. So this was a great project that was created by the local team, to help people love where they live as they're out and about in the community. And then, you know, really the idea of showing up well is from first impression, which is, you see some of our marketing here, and the first impression and a little bit of levity. Your building's from 1905, your toilet shouldn't be. It's funny, but it's true, and trying to make sure that we show up well from the first moment all the way to what we consider that last block. Which what you're seeing there is our courier service. And the courier service is driven out of delivery being the service that you need to hit out of the park in Manhattan. And that's a shot of a customer that purchased something, was offered to have us walk it home for her so she wouldn't have to carry it home. That's a great instant delivery mechanism that we've got. We also do have the same day delivery services, which show up in a pre-scheduled time. We also have next day delivery from our million square feet of retail that we've got off the island. And it's just a really, really, that's been a great, great service for us. I'll show you a little bit of what happens. This is pre-grand opening.
So we're excited. And we were very excited when we stopped by and we heard the Lowe's was coming. to the neighborhood. So, and the Upper West Side is a great location.
The neighbors have been happy with what they see because it is such a good, easy flowing store. And at the same time, it opens its doors to people who have an interest in doing different things, from planting, horticulture, which you just walk by on Broadway and there's all your plants and accessories, to coming in and having home items and a variety of other things.
Oh, I think it's terrific. Because I love the store, you know. If I hadn't known it, then I might have said, oh, I wonder what that's going to be like. But since I do know it so well, I'm very, very excited.
They want to understand that it's not big box coming in here, you know, being big box. It's you're coming in with the neighborhood intent in mind to help them love where they live.
So that was a little bit of some clips from our soft opening where we invited the community in and asked them kind of how it looked and got some great feedback from them before our grand opening. And the market director that spoke mentioned it's not big box coming into the city. It was absolutely not. It was, you know, when we saw the magnitude of change that was required, we knew we needed to change just about everything except the premise of why you come to Lowe's in the first place. And so we built these stores from the ground up. We weren't trimming around the edges to try to fit something big into the city. We were building from the ground up. So hopefully when you visit today or tomorrow or the next day, you see that and you get that feeling that it is truly custom fit for Manhattan. So thank you.